Okay, and welcome back. It's time to take a look, even though we can't see it, at the radiation that is falling down on our heads around the clock and going into our bodies through our, what they call, food, and coming into our systems through many other ways as well. With us tonight, Yoichi Shimatsu. He was in Southern California down there. Yoshi, where are you?
Yeah, in the Southland, and good to hear you.
Thank you.
I've been out on the beaches, seen, you've probably seen some pictures in the press, on the online press, maybe the newspaper.
Yeah.
Hundreds of thousands of little, they're called red crabs. They
hold that thought. Yeah. I want to see if Dana's up there in B.C. Yeah. Are you there? There he is.
Hey, hi, folks.
How are you doing, Dana? That's Dana Durnford, who will be with us tonight as well. Our 1-2 punch of two of the two most brilliant analysts and researchers in this field on the planet, without any question, period. This is the program. This is the time. This is the place to hear what's important. All right. Hang on, Dana. We'll be right back to you. Yoshi, go ahead. Now, these little red crabs are washing up.
Well, they're actually, they look like crawfish or like little red lobsters, only maybe 3 inches long, maybe 4 if they're in the adult phase.
Right.
Littering the beaches of Southern California. I was out there on Friday. Got some good photos. I'll put it together in an article. And there's all this talk from the marine biologists, the usual blah, 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 about El Nino, global warming, sort of stuff.
Yeah.
But from what I can tell, from the information I can see, is that these little red crabs are actually the krill. You know, krill, the little red shrimp that feeds so many species, especially whales.
That's food. Dog.
It's a basic food stuff of larger sea mammals. They're the krill of the tropical region of the Pacific.
Huh.
From Mexico down to Chile. Now, they've been washing up in Southern California. It happened in last January, January 2015,
mm-hmm.
more than a year ago, then June 2015, and now in May 2016. So there's been 3 incidents where hundreds of thousands of them wash ashore. I got photos of that for you. And from what I can see, they're incapacitated by their inability to swim very quickly. These are swimming crabs.
Uh-huh.
They swim like lobsters. They swim backwards. They're powerful little swimmers. And there's this discussion among marine biologists who say they came up because El Nino pushed them up because of the warming waters in the Southlands,
right.
in the southern part of the Pacific.
Right.
Came to California area, then washed ashore. Well, I dispute that. What I can see is most of them are undersized, meaning they have not eaten enough.
Mm.
They probably came up north because of the shortage of food in the tropical belt. And their main form of food is that they're filtering animals. They filter out plankton, from the California current, which also goes, a branch of that, as we've discussed before, goes down to South America. So basically, they're starving to death, so they move upward. They can swim against the current close to shore. They seem to hang around the kelp because many of them were tangled in kelp. It was a high tide in this last week, very high tides, and they're tangled in the kelp. And the pictures are quite shocking, hundreds of thousands of them dead on the beach. The ones in the water can still swim, but they don't swim well. They're very lethargic. And they just sit there as the hermit crabs butcher off their limbs. It's quite a shocking sight, is the hermit crabs, live inside the shell of mollusks, surround them and take advantage of them.
This is very unnatural, what you're telling me. This is
totally unnatural. This stuff does not happen. They're exhausted. They appear to be starving to death. And worse than that, they appear to be sick. They're very lethargic. I only saw one or two of them swimming briskly. The rest appeared to be like on drugs or something like this. And so therefore, I took readings in the area of kelp, feather kelp, 0.40. That's Fukushima, way beyond Fukushima levels. Larger pieces of kelp.
0.4
Oh, yeah, I'll send you a photo of that.
That's
just shocking
that's
level.
Huge. You're
it's
supposed
huge.
To have, but you're supposed to have 0.0 something, not 0.4. You're supposed to have 0.0 something. This
exactly.
is 1,000 times over.
They're escaping the lack of food. They come up to California. Not only are they starving here, they go around the kelp beds trying to filter out what they can, and that's killing them, weakening them. They're washing ashore dead, okay? A lot of them are washing ashore dead. They're swept up by tides. The ones that are stronger are sort of still in the water, but they're just very lethargic in the tide pools. They're not strong. Now, what does this all mean? The marine biologists are telling us, well, this is because of warmer water, El Nino. Well, they swim against the current also. And the warm water from Mexico up past Coronado Island is from the wintertime current. There's a winter current that comes up, you know. So this is long after that current. So they've worked their way up the coast in a desperate search for food. They're dying in droves along the California coast over the last 2 years. What does this all mean? What this all means, again, I say, this is a krill of the tropical zone. I measured them, radioactivity between levels of 0.11 to 0.18. I found one that was in a little hole, 0.18. In other words, all of its liquids, basically, that it's excreting is in that hole. It's highly radioactive. And so basically what's happening, this is they call these crabs tuna crabs, but also they're the main feedstock in the tropics for great whales and blue whales. And we've heard stories of 160 beachings of major whales in Chile, Peru, and so on. This is what's killing the whales and dolphins.
Wow.
And sea lions.
Wow.
This
okay.
is their main diet. This is the krill of the tropic. In other words, the main food stock of what these, the sea turtles also, what they eat is the red crab. The red crab's killing them because they filter out the phytoplankton, the plankton from the oceans. They're great filters. This is how they survive. And they're basically poisoning the higher mammals. So I think this solves the mystery of why all the whales are beaching and dying.
Understand that the reading that you heard Yoshi mention, these are micro sieverts, and it mm-hmm. is supposed to be 0.0. Something. That's okay.
Four,
0.01 is good. You get up to 0.08, you're getting a little dicey. 0.1 is kind of semi-normal now, but you get over 1, you're in trouble. Bad is 0.3 and up. Now he's getting 0.4 readings on the beach.
Yeah.
This is astronomical.
It's like
the Richter scale. It goes up like a thousand fold or something. Oh, man.
So basically, you know, this is the very specific dynamic of this warmer southern region. Dana Durnford, of course, is working on where the North Pacific current hits, much colder waters. But we're seeing this radioactivity along the whole coast. We're seeing marine biologists as openly lying. And we know. I don't want to get into all the details of how I know. They're lying, you know, because I do know people who volunteer, work with these people. They know openly, you know, there's a lot of people who've quit in disgust, I think, you know, in the whole marine biology community. They won't speak out, but they do know there's been a big lie about radiation. NOAA, of course, is a huge funder. They're behind the money. NOAA is the National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration Agency, which basically is a federal agency that's been told to silence the scientists. We've seen the silencing of science go further. If you look at ENE News, you see advertising from Michio Kaku, nuclear physicist.
Yeah.
He's right in there. He's right in there with the futurists. You know, the futurists are very much in with DARPA, okay? I don't want to blow his cover or anything, though, but to see his ad at ENE News, and ENE News talking about a steam explosion at Reactor 3.
Lies. Gross lies. Yeah, gross lies.
You know, this is like the steam explosions at the Boston Marathon. Remember those guys were throwing pressure cookers out of the back of a truck or something like that? Come on. We don't believe in such fairy tales, you know? I mean, these are not...
I couldn't believe it, Yoshi, when I saw a steam explosion in Reactor 3, the MOX reactor. That was a plutonium bomb, basically, folks.
It was a fusion reaction.
And it blew the whole reactor core up into the heavens and all over hell. Everywhere.
A reactor is a little stronger than a pressure cooker, okay? It's more than a pressure cooker bomb here, folks. I mean, now they're getting to everybody. They're spreading the money. Obama's about to go out. They're trying to make sure that cover-up goes into the next administration. I'm sorry, folks. These are myths. They're fairy tales. We don't believe it. And, you know, these little dead red crabs, dying red crabs, sad as it is, they're like messengers to us. They're telling us they're lying. They're lying. Figure it out, folks. Oh, darn ocean is radioactive.
Okay, the bottom of the food chain... The little red crab-like creatures and the top of the food chain all dying of the same things, the same way, the same MO, starving to death, no food, low-level radiation poisoning continually building up in them. Here's an ENE News headline. Nuclear expert, largest amount of Fukushima radiation, the largest amount, fell all over the U.S. West Coast and the Pacific Ocean. All right, that was after the blasts.
Yeah, why that's Dr. Koike.
Yeah,
he's the one honest man. He's the one honest man in Japan. Yeah.
I remember him, of course. Don't we hear complaints from the U.S.? He's asking.
Yeah. He's wondering.
No one says anything. We've asked that question for five damn years here. Yeah. Why?
He's
where's the
Japan.
Government?
Yeah, he's in Japan. He realizes a small country, government has had total control. It's got a history of this. He understands it. But the United States that talks about the free press, freedom of speech and all that, are gagged. He can't figure it out. He says, why? Things are dying there. People are dying there. Why can't they speak out in the United States?
There are going to be millions of people dying here in the next 5 to 10 years. Slow deaths, cancer deaths, lots of money for the AMA and the medical establishment. Yeah. The average cancer patient's worth over $1 million in profits now. Yeah. Dana Durnford, this is all not a surprise to you, of course. Our colleague in BC, who is the man who traveled 15,000 miles up and down the coast by himself, largely in a Zodiac 21-foot boat, checking the islands, had an underwater video camera on a stick, and he had photography, he had long cameras, and he documented the whole thing. It's all there. It's dead up there. It's got the tide pools look like they're on Venus or somewhere else. It's that bad. And it's moving to the south, just as we predicted.
Yeah, it's here.
Dana?
Yeah, Yoshi already, like you say, showed that part of the coastline. And we got enough headlines showing the die-offs throughout the whole coastline. So good to just get eyes on the ground down there. And Yoshi's very thoughtful, right? You know,
yeah.
In everything he does. Not that you're talking like a third person or anything, but that's the extinction event is not going to change the 4.2 other million species that didn't recede the coastline. And so this is just like over the top. In other words, all the species in the ocean should have just jumped in and filled up the gap, or the same species should have filled up the gap. And he didn't do it because he couldn't do it. And because this stuff is not, like you say, every conversation about it, the experts will tell you it's like a banana and a potato chip. But if you look at the studies on the animals, you find out it's not. If you look at the studies throughout history on it, it has nothing to do with that. But, like, Jeff, you know how hard it is to have a conversation. Yoshi, you know, you can't have a conversation without bringing up bananas and potato chips. It's ludicrous. It's one of the most...
Yeah. It's one of the biggest lies of our time.
Yeah.
70 years.
Yeah, people do freeze up. I agree with you, Dan. A lot of people, you just mentioned the word radioactivity, they just freeze up on you. They just, you know... They just can't handle it.
I forget the name of the airline. One of the airlines allows flight crews now to fly the North Pacific route once a month. That's their limit. Then they have to send a different crew. One time a month they can fly.
That's the mission. Yeah, it's rough. I've been on those planes. I don't feel good afterwards. You know, I have terrible problems afterwards.
Oh, I believe it. So you're okay. So there it is. If you folks fly the Asian route from the U.S., and you don't feel good when you get to your destination, there's a damn good reason for it. Understand that. Listen, you're not hallucinating. You're exposed. Wow. All right. Dana, so what's going on up there? It's springtime. Obviously, the songbirds are everywhere. The seabirds are just flooding the coast, and the tourists are there looking at the tide pools and taking pictures, and it's a glorious spring.
The whole industry is on its back with its leg up in the air, legs up in the air, because they closed the whole coastline to commercial industry because of red tide, is what they're saying.
Ah, yes.
We've never seen that one before, see? But that's the word today, that the whole fishery, everything is closed off, can't go anywhere and do anything on the whole coastline. I'm going to launch an expedition coming up in the next 6 weeks or so to go back up the coast one more run at it. Minimum anyway, because we got everything sitting there, and do comparisons of the other previous expeditions in desperation, in just utter desperation. And this time we really truly want to try the stream alive. I think that was the one that was missing, and the technology has gotten a lot better since last year, and we might be able to pull it off in high quality. We got the equipment, all the important equipment that are ready to do it, so. And well motivated. Right. I think I'll just finish off on that, is that live streaming it out the whole coastline, an extinction event, just pumping it hardcore for a couple of weeks straight, say 2 weeks or 3 weeks, just doing the whole coastline. I think that might just actually break the paradigm to pieces. They can't deny it. They're denying it now, but I don't think you can deny a live stream of the entire coastline with a bit of support. And we have that ability. What do you think, Yoshi? I don't know.
Well, Dana, one thing I recommend is, it's just Muslim cotton. Take a plankton net. It's just like basically like an insect net, a little maybe finer material. Collect the plankton, put it through your microscope, and see if we have the red algae. That's a total lie. And I'll tell you why it's a total lie.
I finally found
actual charts and maps at the California Department of Public Health, which does a monthly red tide report. And what they found out was that levels are very low. Levels are very, very low. So. I have to quiet down. I'm waking up my neighbors here. They're complaining. So anyway,
I've never seen any evidence of it. And I haven't heard people talking about it. Yeah. And I have friends of mine.
Your neighbors are complaining?
Yeah. I'm shouting a little bit because, we're talking in a bad reception area.
So anyway, I see.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So anyway, basically, if you could take some plankton readings, I think that will dispel the notion of red. And that will just conform with what the California Department of Public Health is saying.
Uh-huh.
Levels are very, very low. In fact, the highest level readings we're getting is around where Diablo Canyon nuclear reactor feeds into the Pacific. That's got the highest levels. I'll be sending you the charts later on with my article.
Huh.
And it'll just show there is no red tide threat. None.
Any idea that Diablo may be leaking and encouraging that higher reading in that area?
I do think, a lot of the leaks is not just heat. There's hot water, but there may be also like radionucleotides that may be promoting, types of phosphates and so on that are promoting the growth of these algae.
Right.
I'm not sure, but I think there is a correlation because it's too close to Diablo Canyon to discount, so. But further south, not really a problem. Newport Harbor, because of the boats coming in and out, a lot of bunker oil.
That's where I grew up.
I grew up
in Newport, and it used to be absolutely wonderful in the old days. Yeah.
Well, right now, like south of there, San Diego, it's clear, so there is no. And that would be the warmest water, and it would be a very low-level threat. So that means that there is no red tide threat, so. That's totally bogus. Domoic acid is part of that red tide threat. It's totally bogus. And we're going to have to just bust that myth once and for all. And, not that these guys won't keep repeating it.
This nuclear engineer, Hiroaki Koide, in the article I mentioned earlier at ENE, a couple of these quotes are important. They've been translated. He says, now strontium-90 has been leaking from Fukushima into the ocean, so it will eventually reach the United States. Well, it already has.
It has.
It only takes a few days to get across, especially the West Coast. This much, we said this in early March, this much we are sure of. It is the masses of people who need to realize the impact of the radiation, that contamination, on them. The people need to realize it. They're not going to get it from the government, is what he's saying. In the case of the Fukushima disaster, for example, they need to be aware that radioactive material is reaching the North American coast, and the prevailing westerly winds will carry anything released into the atmosphere right over to the U.S. Okay, do you follow that, folks? It's coming over here constantly, whether it be streams and plumes in the ocean water or streams and plumes in the air. It doesn't matter. We're getting it continually. And when it comes across the ocean in the water and crashes against the shore, the waves churn up this micro marine layer of mist, of moisture, and a lot of that is contaminated. That moves inland. Wherever the marine layer can be smelled, you can be sure you're getting low dose all the time of radiation coming from. And nobody says anything about this incinerator burning of radioactive debris in Japan. It goes on in every major city, every medium-sized city, and no one says a word about it. Nothing, nothing. Has Obama ever said anything about it? Has anyone ever said anything about it? No. We're about it. Though there are a few others, but not many. Not many. And the people, sacrificial sheep. That's all they are. They don't count. They die, so what? We make money on it. There's money in death. Remember that. Stand by. Be right back. Good night. So the subject at hand, which is radioactivity, which is all around you, wherever you are right now, and varying concentrations. If you live within 50 miles of a nuclear power plant, you are in the zone of that plant, which releases radiation every damn day. The rest of it all comes from Japan, but beyond that, it's still coming down from the 1950s atmospheric tests that these formerly United States conducted. And there was a hell of a lot of stuff thrown up into the atmosphere. It's still there. It's still coming down. A little bit more from this interview with Professor Koide, the nuclear engineer. He said, a smaller share of the total contamination will have fallen on Japan compared with the Pacific Ocean, with the largest portion falling on the west coast of the United States, talking about the radiation from Fukushima. He goes on to say, so why don't we hear complaints from the U.S.? Why are there no calls for compensation? Whenever someone asks me this, I simply say, there just aren't any. No complaints. Why is this so? Well, the levels released by the U.S. during the atmospheric testing, were tens of times greater than Fukushima. They are the criminals, so they cannot ask for compensation from Japan. The U.S. government doesn't want to have to reflect on its own past, and I think they are eager to completely avoid bringing up anything like Fukushima in any conversation. So as bad as Fukushima is, the atmospheric tests were far worse over a much broader area, and no one was told about anything except, you know, get ready when you're in school, duck and cover, or if you're an Army enlisted man or draftee, you're out in the desert, they give you sunglasses and tell you to watch the explosion with your sunglasses. And those people were all sacrificed. It's all nuts. Do you know we had nuclear artillery shells in the 1950s called the Davy Crockett? They actually had an artillery piece, a big gun, a cannon, could shoot a nuclear atomic battlefield tactical atomic warhead. Boom, mushroom cloud, the whole thing. So we've come a long way. The thermonuclear weapons now are very small. It's not unusual to hear people talking about, who know, DARPA and so on, about softball-sized nuclear bombs. Look at 9/11. Those were very small nuclear weapons used in there in terms of their physical size. But look at the damage. They just gutted the towers. And they just came down like a bunch of atomic dust, which is really basically what it turned into, a lot of it. All right, anyway, Japan, not good. Southern California is getting a look by Yoshi, not good. We know about the British Columbia coast. What are you planning to do down there next? Anything else? Have you even tried to go to any of these sea life, sea mammal rescue centers to talk to these people?
Yeah, I have, and there's a big sign about domoic acid there. So, and I know volunteers who've quit in disgust because, you know, the marine mammal centers are sponsored. They get money from NOAA, and so that covers most of their staff.
Well, there it is. Yeah.
You know, there you go. You know, he who pays the piper calls the tune, right?
Yeah.
So, and NOAA is just—it's disgraceful. It's betraying the people of this country. It's betraying everything that this country stands for. And I think so. I hope the next administration has a sense to bring all this back into line, because there won't be much time after that. You know, the Tokyo Olympics will be pushed right after the Brazil Olympics, you know, the Zika Olympics in this August, and then we're going to have the Fukushima Olympics in 2020, you know, four years after that. So we've got to push hard. And then the other problem is that June, you know, there's going to be the G7, the Group of Seven meeting in Japan. Some of the tech ministers are there now, but in June, all the big leaders of the major industrial powers will be there, minus Vladimir Putin. He used to be a G8. He's out. You know, he's realized what that group is about. They're going to be there, serve as a, and Obama's going to Hiroshima, you know, as everyone knows, with nothing to say about that. Okay, no apology, no explanation. Just go there and try to, do his usual thing, you know, show that he cares, but we're not really sure what he really cares about. You know, all in vague language. And meanwhile, in June, July, the rains are going to start, and that's when Tokyo Electric Power is going to dump all that strontium, all of that tritium, into the Pacific Ocean in large amounts. I think they dumped a lot in April, when the last rainy season is, and it's been affecting the Arctic region. All the scientists are squawking about how the Arctic ice is just like crumbling, it's gone, you know, and it's the end of the Arctic, the end of the polar bear. I think that's no secret now. That's all caused by tritium and the nuclear isotopes out of Fukushima. But the big wave will happen coincident with this Group of Seven meeting of the world's great industrial powers. They'll all be there to sort of endorse Japan's destruction of whatever's left of the Pacific Rim region, of life on the Pacific. It's really sick that government heads, they know what's going on. They know what's going on.
Well, of course, and as I've said before, this government is measuring things 24/7. They have buoys, they have barkers, they have testing in the air at varying altitudes, they have testing in the water, probably down to 300-500 meters. They know exactly how much contamination and pollution is in the ocean. You ever hear anything about that, Dana, up there, about measurements of any substance? You've got no more ice up there. And we talk about strontium and so forth, and we mention a few of the radionuclides, but there really are in those tanks of water, aren't there? There are hundreds of different kinds, potentially, different nuclides. It's not just one or two or three. There's tons of them.
Yeah, I get arrested for the last guys who were making all the noise on the coastline that they were out there testing. They're only testing water, allegedly, offshore.
Uh-huh.
Instead of testing the coastline and the marine life and stuff like that. But you're not getting any kind of like my Geiger counter right now, 158 counts a minute. And
indoors, 158.
That's indoors, yeah. This morning it was 280. Dropped down to 150, 170 for quite a while. But 55 is evacuation zone. Germany only allows 5 Becquerels after an accident. So my numbers are just way, that's an inspector. You know, that guy who wrote the article about Japan and about weapons testing, one way to look at it is like if a bomb explodes on the ground, it can consume 1 million tons and ionizing radiate. Excuse me that. But a military reactor is something different. And I equate a melted reactor to worse than all the pollution ever created on the planet. Multiply that by infinity, still can't match up to what radiation does. So if you've got a bucket of shrimp and or a bucket of fish or whatever the case may be, it's a 200-pound bucket of fish. Now, in the very middle of that bucket is one fish, and he got a single atom into him with some isotopes from a chain reaction. That, you can pick that up in one sense, the particle itself, from outside the container. So all the fish now becomes radiated all around it. It's the same thing if it was shrimp or something like that, or krill. And so it can shoot out just the energy up to 4 feet out. But when you take it in the context of what happened at Chernobyl, one-third the size of any of the reactors was 30% meltdown. It didn't have reactor cores on the roof in the fuel pools that were on the roof. I've been hammering away at that all week. But we're talking about many, 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 many reactors in Japan compared to Fukushima. And Chernobyl. And Chernobyl, look at all the damage to that. It's incredible, inconceivable. 600 pilots, over 1 million people from 2,500 studies that died from fallout. There's over 3,000 children with disabilities, according to Kofi Annan at UN 2000. And the list keeps going on and on. Less than 3% of the children born while in the womb during Chernobyl were healthy after. And Japan, everything north of Tokyo, all the food is barred in some country. There's that much radiation coming out of there.
Yeah.
There's no comparison to the weapons testing. But weapons testing wasn't a joke. And the average background radiation worldwide was 30 becquerels, say 40 becquerels. And Japan, it's dirt. These are breeder reactors. These are constantly producing fresh isotopes. The rods blew all over the site, and they're producing their own isotopes. It's such an emergency, and every time that you talk about it, this is an extinction event for everything. It's not just the Pacific Ocean, and we got to get everything. Like we were talking about freezing product, animals and creatures, and storing that for the future for generations.
Won't
be us. Yeah, that is how we got to be acting and thinking. It's shocking to even say stuff like that. But if you go out, and I'll finish on that, if you go out and look at the coastline, or you look at the pictures at the nuclearproctologist.org of the coastline, the other 4 million species didn't show up, and it's an extinction event. You can't change anything when you haven't stopped the reactors. Like you were saying earlier, they're burning it in the incinerators at 300,000 becquerels a kilogram of cesium, but they're not checking for everything else. It's shocking.
Yeah.
These are dirty bombs.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'll just let Yoshi jump in there. Go ahead, Yoshi.
Yeah. And the thing about the past history of nuclear weapons testing, in nearly all those tests, most of the fuel did not explode. A lot of it just fell to the ground, okay? So we're talking about, theoretically, there was a lot of material released, but in fact, probably only about 30% of that was actually released. And luckily, very luckily, too bad for the nuclear bomb designers, but lucky for the rest of us. And that did succeed. And, I don't know what people think of Chris Busbett, but he's saying that millions of people, and I've heard similar stories of that, millions and millions of people actually died of cancer. A lot of that was blamed on tobacco smoking and pesticides. And, I think there's a synergy, of course. There's a synergy here. You know, it's like the tipping point thing. All that stuff's bad for you, but the more of it you've got, and radiation.
Where do you think these people who get lung cancer who never smoked got it? How does that happen?
Exactly.
A lot of that is radiation. Sure.
And a lot of the radiation did get into the tobacco. Tobacco is a huge absorber of radioactive compounds. So basically, we really don't know if Busby's right. He's saying millions of people, hundreds of millions of people died of cancer. And we do know in the 60s and 70s, a whole slew of people did die of cancer. It was just so prevalent. And so the whole disease of cancer, I know because in Thailand, I lived in Thailand, it was an unknown disease. 50 years ago, there was zero cancer in Thailand. It was never known.
Hmm.
So obviously, it's a new disease. It has to do with the kind of technologies, the chemicals, you know, the chemicals we use, and also nuclear on top of that. And nuclear is like the tipping point. It's bad enough we use all these chemicals, but we have that as a tipping point. An extinction event, what Dana says, that is simply not an exaggeration. We're seeing with these beachings of all this basic red crab out there, which is a food stuff for whales, and all the whales mm-hmm. dying, there's mm-hmm. obviously correlation. There is a massive extinction event going on in the Pacific of, you know, humongous proportion. If we think of the distance from, let's say, California past Mexico, past Central America, past Peru, down to Chile, we're talking like vast, vast terrain, just unthinkable volumes of water, you know, unthinkable. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay, unthinkable volumes of water.
Wow, and again, no idea of a technology to go in and try to rectify or remedy the situation. It's, you can't remediate it. They don't, now they're just admitting now, after how many years we've been telling people, that they think the core is melted down through the concrete and are now in pieces, maybe micro pieces, in the groundwater. Yeah, really? Surprise, it's over. It's not a damaged nuclear power plant, it's a destroyed nuclear power plant. And they can't really put a sarcophagus over it. It doesn't matter anymore. The stuff's underneath it, into the groundwater. It's not something that can be capped. Plus, it's sitting on fill material. It wouldn't last anyway. So it's bad. The big problem remains, how long can these spent fuel pools and reactors 1, 2, and 3 stay up there? That's, to me, something that nobody talks about it anymore. They can't unload those fuel pools. They pulled stuff out of fuel pool 4 because the reactor there didn't blow like the rest of them. It wasn't supposedly fueled up. So I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen. How do we deal with these spent fuel pools in 1, 2, and 3, Yoshi?
Yeah, well, you know that U.S. military helicopters were used to quell the fires, and they flew over these reactors. And the Pentagon put, you know, American crews and helicopters at the disposal of the Japanese government and Tokyo Electric Power. You don't see any helicopters flying over the plant now. I mean, the reality is, you know, their alarms went off. I hate to think of what actually happened to the crews of those helicopters who, you know, and... Yeah, I hate to, you know, is it naive the word, you know, and their idea that they could help? We really don't know what happened to them. You know, it's like the people can just disappear today, as we know, you know, in the recent modern wars. And I think a lot of people who served over, you know, around and over Fukushima, American mm-hmm. personnel, have just never been heard from again, you know, and some of them.
It's easy to make people vanish, I agree. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And something like there was like, 30 other American vessels, naval vessels involved.
There were a lot of them, and not a word about any of that. Nothing to represent the soldiers and the men and women who were in the Navy, nothing. They're just being...
And these helicopters flew, yeah, when Reactor 3 exploded, yeah, this very famous explosion, March 15th, and released all the nucleotides, and fuel rods were being blown into the sky, and were... going melting through the reactor wall and going underground. There were American helicopters over there. We these people must have been just wiped off the face of the earth and put into VA hospitals overseas. There's a lot of VA hospitals overseas, military hospitals, and have just been disappeared. So this is just as bad as anything that happened in Iraq or Syria or wherever. Iraq, especially, or Afghanistan, and no investigation. And I wish Congress would take the responsibility, find out exactly what happened in that week after the Fukushima disaster.
Congress, the word Congress and responsibility don't fit in the same paragraph.
I know. Yeah, I know. I think it's very, you know, I don't agree with the protesters out there, but I understand why people will protest and call for the need for democracy, because there is none. We need a democracy of information. Obviously, we're not getting much, and although there are bits and pieces slipping through the system, as you know, occasionally you'll see some, disconcerted statements in the AP or, you know, UPI. Information does slip through, and reporters just can't, and editors just can't take it anymore. But then it's quelled right away. There are minders, obviously, official censors. So we're really still up against it as the Obama administration goes in the lame duck, you know, condition.
They're not going to do anything.
This administration is going to fight against the nuclear truth all the way, you know, all the way. And we just hope the next one will do something. We'll finally deal with this reality. This is as bad as Guantanamo, because Guantanamo happened, the guys who, you know, who were admittedly on the other side or whatever. This is happening to people so-called on our side, you know, Americans and Japanese on our side who are being allowed to be put down. We need to know the truth. You know, we cannot let, back in the Vietnam War days, you know, Americans who were left behind in the secret war, you know, and were abandoned by Henry Kissinger and Colin Powell. There was a yellow ribbon movement, and I think we need something like that today for all the yellow ribbons of American servicemen who somehow have vanished from sight after Fukushima, after doing their best at Fukushima. It's sickening what goes on, that Obama will go to Hiroshima and will ignore what's happening today. This is just like sickening duplicity and hypocrisy.
Have you got any news at all about the physical remnants of the Fukushima plant, what's going on there in terms of subsidence of the steel that's being degraded constantly? What's left of those buildings?
We just had the earthquake in Ibaraki Prefecture, but no readings out of Fukushima. Okay, now this is a neighboring province, and as I reported in my last article, this was along that same median fault line, along the San Andreas Fault of Japan. And then we predicted it, right? Yeah, and there was just an earthquake along that line under Tsukuba University, where that fault line goes into the sea. Probably Fukushima is next. Okay, this whole fault line has been active along the entire length of the main island.
Yeah, and the point is, we have 99 active reactors left in the U.S. There used to be 104. They're almost all operating at the end of their useful lives, if they had any useful lives to begin with. Many have been given 20-year extensions. This is beyond negligence. It's insanity.
Yeah. It's criminal. It's criminal insanity, because these things are just rusted. The pipes just don't last that long. There's no real effort.
They're leaky. Gas is coming out of them. Water's coming out of them. Look at Indian Point. Yeah. It's actually polluting the Hudson River. And the government, I understand that Governor Cuomo and his attorney general have tried to shut that plant down, and they've been met with resistance from the feds.
Yeah. Unless there's change in the federal government, nothing's going to be done. And, you know, the extinction event is reaching into the human population in North America. And people got to understand, it's not just animals that are dying. You know, the number of pet deaths, apparently, are increasing all over Western states.
Oh.
Pets are dying at earlier ages from cancer-like conditions, brain tumors, and so on. So we're seeing just this flurry of death going on. We're talking about the Hudson River. We're talking about the Ohio River with that Metropolis plant.
And the Columbia River.
Columbia River. The major rivers are being basically, there's nowhere, you know, once you contaminate them, it's going to take a century to even begin to dredge them out.
I don't think it can be done.
It's going to be billions and billions of dollars. I mean, shut the plants down now and save the cost and the effort of all that.
Right? Well, Hanford,
it makes no sense. You have to squeeze out a little bit more of energy that's not necessary when the economy is down, right? The economy is down.
Right.
There's more efficiency in appliance use. So it makes no sense why they don't shut them down now when the time is
right.
This Obama administration, incredible. I would say they're perpetrators of this extinction event.
Well, they are. Dana, are there any nuclear power plants in British Columbia?
No, good thing, too. There's 230 counts a minute here, so...
You're up to 230?
230. 241.
Uranium export.
Yeah. Oh, my.
250.
250? Inside.
Sorry.
All right. That's
I'm sure everyone.
That's amazing. Thanks, Dana.
So. Good night, everyone.
All right.
Good luck. Good luck on your next trip, Dan. Good luck.
Yeah, you bet, my friend.
Well, Yoshi, if he's getting 250 indoors up there, there are cells of this stuff that move through, waves of it. And it's
terrible. They're just shipping it out like crazy, as if, uranium is going out of style. And maybe it is. They're going to ship it out all over the world and contaminate what's left is going to be destroyed.
You know, people talk about colonizing Mars. What bothers me about that is we'll take the same psychotic mentality up there with us. We'll start to pollute that planet. Do the same thing.
Unless a species has a change of heart, change of mind, we're finished. Life on Earth is finished, and life in the solar system, it will be gone.
I'm afraid you're right. Thank you. Take care. Talk to you next week. All right. Yoichi Shimatsu and Dana Durnford and I will be back tomorrow night with all of you, I hope, and we will talk to Adrian Salbucci, coming up from Argentina, Gordon Duff, Jim Kerwin, our man in San Francisco. It will be an interesting program tomorrow night. Hope you have a good day. Take care.